Chapter 7, Permanent Magnet Synchronous Machines. In this chapter I would like to explain a little bit the advantages and disadvantages of this type of machine for the application in the railway sector. First, we will take a look at the advantages of the machine. So why should we use a permanent magnet machine? Secondly, we will see what are the disadvantages and why is this machine still not used very often in the railway sector. And finally, we'll also have a look at how to produce such a machine, how to ensure the quality, and also at some products and applications of a permanent magnet machine in the railway sector. So for the electric machine in the vehicle, there are different options. You can use a commutator machine, which was done for a long time in the 20th century. Then with the rise of power electronics, the induction machine came up and is at the moment the machine which is mostly used in railway application. But you also could use a synchronous machine. And within the synchronous machines, there are also three options. So you could use a synchronous reluctance machine, an electrically excited synchronous machine, or the permanent magnet synchronous machine. So why is the permanent magnet synchronous machine so attractive? You can, for example, compare the different machine types and look at the efficiency and the losses. This was done a couple of years ago for a conventional synchronous generator, so electrically excited synchronous machine, an induction machine, and a permanent magnet synchronous machine. And so for the conventional synchronous generator with electrical excitation, you usually get an efficiency between 92 and 94%. For the induction machine of approximately the same size, you see that the efficiency is around 94 to 95%. But for the permanent magnet generator, you could reach efficiency in most part of the operating range at approximately 97%. And this is already a really high value. And you can see the difference even more clearly when you look at the losses of the machine. So for the same operating point at 1800 RPM and 360 kilowatts mechanical input power, you see that the electrically excited synchronous machine used as a generator in this operating point has losses of approximately 20 kilowatts. When you use the induction machine in this operating point, the losses go down to approximately 16 kilowatts. But now look at the permanent magnet synchronous machine. In this case, you have at this operating point losses of only 9 kilowatts. So this is a huge difference to the other machines. So what's the reason for this difference? Well, it's basically the way of excitation. So the magnetic flux in the machine at the conventional synchronous generator is generated by a current. So you need a current to produce the excitation field. And also for the induction machine, you have a current in the stator as well as a current in the rotor. And for the permanent magnet synchronous machine, the excitation is done by permanent magnets. So the permanent magnets produce a magnetic flux all of the time and they don't need an additional source of energy. When you remember chapter 6, where we talked about the cooling concept, it was said that for the encapsulated machine design, it is quite difficult to get the losses out of the rotor. So usually the encapsulated machine design is limited to a certain power, because otherwise you cannot get rid of the losses. But for the permanent magnet synchronous machine, you have the big advantage that the losses, especially in the rotor, are lower. And so there are not so many losses that you have to get rid of. And for that reason, you can use the encapsulated machine design also for machines of higher power. And then the machine is protected against dirt and damage, especially the winding is protected, but also the permanent magnets. And the machine features a very low noise level. Some time ago, we made another comparison. So we took an induction machine and took out the rotor and replaced it with a permanent magnet rotor. We also exchanged the winding, because for the permanent magnet machine we used an 8-pole winding, whereas for the induction machine we used a 4-pole motor concept. And what we could see is that when even for the same size of the machine, we could raise the power. So the power increased from 120 kilowatts to 200 kilowatts continuous power output. And this is not the complete truth, so you must also for instance look at the speed of the machine at which this power is produced. And so the speeds slightly differ, but to get the whole truth you can look at the torque. And the torque increased from 670 newton meters to a number very close to 1000 newton meters. And that's already much more, so the torque was increased by approximately 50%. And what's very interesting to see, the air cooling quantity kept the same, the mass kept the same, the power was increased, but at the same time even the efficiency was increased. So the result was quite an attractive machine at the same size. Some years later we built another permanent magnet synchronous machine, and in this case a power of 160 kilowatts was sufficient. And if you look at the torque, it has approximately the same torque, but the mass is considerably lower. This motor was intended for electric bus, so in this case the mass requirements are very often demanding, so it was important to have a motor with a low mass. And again you can see that the efficiency was increased to 96%. So even although the output power was increased by 33%, the mass of the machine was significantly lower. But if everything seems to be so attractive about this machine, so why isn't it used so much in railway applications? We will see that during the next slides. One problem are the permanent magnets, because the permanent magnets always produce a magnetic flux. And you know that the induced voltage is proportional to the change of flux in time. So if the machine speed increases, also the induced voltage increases. And with increasing speed of the machine, the voltage becomes higher and higher. And at a certain point, the maximum voltage of the inverters, so of the semiconductor components, could be exceeded. So it is not easy to find an economical solution where the semiconductors don't become too expensive, because when they are suitable for a high voltage, they become more expensive. And on the other hand, that the system is secure so that the induced voltage does not impose any problems for the semiconductor components. A possible solution would be a switch between the inverter and the machine, but again this switch will cost some money, so again the costs go up. Another problem with the permanent magnet, and that they always produce a magnetic flux, and that they always induce a voltage when the machine is running is that if there is a short circuit in the machine, then as long as the machine is turning, there will be a short circuit. And then all of the time a current is flowing in the machine, and this current heats up the machine. And this is a real issue for the railway, because as we already know, usually not only one motor is used in a train, but there are several motors. So for example, you have 4 or 8 or 12 motors, and if for example 8 motors are in the train and one motor has a short circuit and the 7 others are still okay, so they are still working and driving the train, the other motor with the short circuit, it also runs all the time because he's connected to the rails, and so he always produces a short circuit current, and this heats up the machine, and the only way to stop the short circuit flowing is to stop the train. And then again, if you want to pull away the train or get it away from the place where it is standing, then again the short circuit will come back again. So of course there are also solutions for this. For example, if you design the machine appropriately so that you can run, for example, 5 minutes or 10 minutes even with the short circuit, and the machine does not start to overheat in a way that it starts burning, then this could be a possible solution. Also, the magnets suffer from this short circuit because they will heat up, and the permanent magnets are very sensitive to heat. So there are two ways to handle this. Either you use magnets which can withstand the higher temperature and they don't have any problem also with the short circuit current, or the other solution would be you use magnets that lose the magnetization in such a case, and then also the short circuit current would be much lower. But of course then you cannot use this machine with these magnets anymore, as long as you can't magnetize them again. And the magnetic flux not only is inducing a voltage in the stator winding, but it is also a source of losses. And in case of the permanent magnet machine, as we already know, we cannot switch off the magnetic flux, and so you will always have losses in the machine as long as the machine is turning. And the losses increase especially with the rotating frequency. So if the machine drives at a higher speed, then also the losses are higher. And this is something very inconvenient for railway vehicles, for example, for long distance trains, for intercity trains or high speed trains, because long distance trains, usually when they reach a certain speed, they will not use full power anymore, but they're running at a high speed. And in this case, an induction machine does not have very high losses, but the permanent magnet machine has, because they have these core losses which are related to the flux which you cannot change, and also to the rotating frequency. As we will see on the next slide, there is a way to reduce the flux also in the permanent magnet machine, but this requires a current. And this current as well produces a loss. So you have to balance then the core losses and the additional copper losses. So we already know now that the magnetic flux by the permanent magnets can impose some problems. On the one hand, the voltage can become too high, and on the other hand, also the losses can be too high. But as I already said, you can do something about it. So if you see here the induced voltage, and here you see the voltage drop, and finally, so this is the voltage what you see at the terminals of the machine, then you could use another current like this, so that you get as a result a lower voltage at the terminal. So this is possible, and then you can clearly see that the resulting voltage at the terminals can become much lower, but you see here that you need a current for that, and this current of course produces additional losses. The good news is that with some machine configurations you can also make use of this additional current what you need, because as you can see here in the formula, you can use this ID current together with the IQ current to produce an additional part of the torque. Another thing, what is not so easy to handle, is the temperature dependency of the flux of the permanent magnets. And this means, if the temperature of the magnets goes up, then the flux of the magnetic flux will drop. And as you can see to the right, there's quite a big difference between the cold magnets and the hot magnets. So for example, for the material what is mostly used for the permanent magnet machines, neodymium iron boron, between 0 degrees Celsius and 100 degrees Celsius, the magnetic flux changes at approximately 10%. So at the hot temperature, it's about 10% lower than at cold temperature. And if you use more advanced magnet material, you can use it also at higher temperature. So you can basically get more out of the machine. And if you also consider that the temperature can sometimes also be lower, then you have a temperature range from approximately minus 20 degrees to plus 180 degrees. And within this temperature range, then the magnetic flux changes for approximately 20%. And this is really a huge value. And it's a problem on the one side of the range, so it's a problem for cold temperatures, because then the induced voltage is very high. And it's also a problem at hot temperatures, because then the induced voltage can become too low, and also as a result of the lower flux, the torque of the machine can be lower, or will be lower, unless you feed another current or more current. So when the machine becomes hot, this leads typically to a torque reduction of the motor or a voltage reduction of the generator. Of course, again, there is a solution to that. There's a different magnet material, and this is called samarium cobalt, and this magnet material has a much lower temperature coefficient than neodymium iron boron. The temperature coefficient is then 3 times smaller, and this makes the voltage dependency on the temperature much more convenient for the application. Another difficulty is, compared to the induction machine, that the permanent magnet synchronous machine is a synchronous machine. And this means that the current has to be controlled exactly in dependency of the actual rotor position. So you need at every time information about the position of the rotor. So usually you would use a position sensor, and this position sensor also costs some money, especially if it's valid for railway applications. Of course, there are other solutions also. For example, you can use sensorless control, but this is more sophisticated on the control side. And related to the induction machine, you have another disadvantage, because for an induction machine, you very often use one inverter to feed two machines, because then you can save significant amount of costs. Because you need the rotor position for a permanent magnet machine to control it, you need a single inverter for every machine. So that means if you have two motors, you also need two inverters, whereas for the induction machine, you can use one inverter for two machines. And this only makes no difference if there is a vehicle which uses only one machine. And finally, there's also the price of the permanent magnets. For quite a long time, so before 2010, the price for the permanent magnets was reasonable. So there was technical development and the permanent magnets became better and better, and so they became attractive for high power density machines, and the price was still on a level what you could accept. But at this time, when the price level was quite low, China became the only supplier, and then suddenly in 2011 the prices went up. And when you look what happened in the beginning of 2011, the prices went up and went up and went up, and it seems that they were not stopping. So you were not sure if you manufacture a permanent magnet machine now, and you have a contract to manufacture them also during the next year, then you did not know which would be the cost for the machine in the next year. And this is something what was a very big problem for the permanent magnet machine, because suddenly nobody wanted to buy a permanent magnet machine because you could not be sure what would be the price for it in the future. Fortunately, after some time, the prices went down again, but still the price development is a significant issue, because also now you will never know what happens, if this can happen again, and what will happen next, and if the prices will be stable or not. So in a very short way, some words about the production of permanent magnet machines and the quality issues. So typically for permanent magnet machines in railway application, specific magnets are used. So according to your needs, you choose a certain kind of magnets what fulfill your requirements. So you can choose with different materials. As I already mentioned, that there are the neodymium iron boron magnets and the samarium cobalt magnets. And you can also choose a different material composition. Then it will become different grades of magnets. And you can also do, for example, as you can see it in the picture in the middle, a segmentation of the magnets to lower the losses inside the magnets. So it's quite common that for different projects you use magnets of different size, different material composition, different magnetic grade, sometimes even different material. And what's also important about the magnets is that we usually do a 100% quality check. So that means that every magnet is checked for its magnetic flux before it is built into the machine. The neodymium iron boron magnets are also prone to corrosion because they contain a big share of iron. So there are special ways to keep them resistant against corrosion. They are also brittle material, so you should check what happens when they are subject to vibrations. And of course you must build the machine in a way that the magnets keep in their position inside the rotor. And for example, we did a push out force test after we glued in the magnets. Here you see a way how to make an end-of-line inspection of the quality of the magnets when they are already inserted into the rotor lamination. So you can automatically scan the magnetic flux on the outside of the machine, and then you get information if the magnets are basically okay and if they are inserted in the right direction. So we could see that there are many difficulties to use the permanent magnet machine, especially when you use it as a motor in a railway vehicle. but most of these disadvantages disappear when you use it as a generator, because then it is not connected physically to the rails, it is decoupled. Here you can see the example of a generator, liquid-cooled permanent magnet generator for a narrow gauge vehicle in Sicily, in Italy. A permanent magnet generator was also used for a diesel electric multiple unit, which was built in Croatia. In this case, also the rectifier, so the power electronics for the machine, were included in the terminal box of the generator. And the whole diesel generator unit was placed on the roof of the vehicle. Here you can see the permanent magnet generator for a shunting loco, a hybrid shunting loco. Quite a big permanent magnet generator is also used in the Bombardier Trucks diesel electric multi-engine locomotive. And what is special about this locomotive concept is that you have four diesel generator sets in the locomotive. So if you don't need so much power, you can switch off the diesel motor with its generator, and you can use the other diesel gensets in the point of their best efficiency. When you look at the power of this generator, it has an output power of 530 kilowatts, and this is something what is already a really high value for an encapsulated machine. So for example, you would not build an induction machine with this power as an encapsulated machine anymore, because the losses inside the machine are too high, and then you cannot operate it efficiently or get the power out of it. And for a permanent magnet machine with its quite low losses, it's possible to build an encapsulated machine with even over 500 kilowatts. With a permanent magnet machine, you can also use a special winding configuration. This is called a single tooth winding. And with this winding configuration, you can build very short coils, so very short machines. Such a machine is, for example, used in the Siemens Vectron platform to go the extra mile. So that means the locomotive is basically an electric locomotive, but to use it for shunting, for example, also when you don't have overhead lines, it has a small diesel generator set. And in this case, it is extremely important that the generator is as small as possible. So in this case, we could build a machine with 170 kilowatts maximum power with a length of only 25 centimeters. And such a machine would not be possible as a classical induction machine. As a motor, you will find the permanent magnet machine mostly in vehicles which have only one motor and which are not connected to rails. So this is an example here, a permanent magnet machine used as a motor for an electric bus. So as you can see, the permanent magnet machine is an attractive machine concept which has some benefits. For example, it can offer you a very high efficiency. And it is also a machine where you can realize, for example, encapsulated machines with a power greater than 300 kilowatts. And you can also build, for example, especially short machines, which is not possible in the same way with an induction machine. But still, there are many challenges for the railway application. And at the moment, for the railway application, the number one machine is still the induction machine.